Oh, welcome to the course. As you can see, our speaker is already here. While I am wandering down the list, if you would just say hello to each other, tell us where you're at, what the weather's like, what time of day it is. And then, oh, I see some new people who weren't here yesterday. This is fantastic. So let me head all the way down. Good deal. Very good. So far we don't, Brian is in as a registrant. Yesterday. Oh, lovely.
Oh, yeah, Napoli, all right.
Great. And Finland and Albuquerque, Charlottesville. Forest of Dean. Oh, I've heard of this on the Welsh border. Hi, Rachel. I was just emailing you. Hello, everybody. Welcome to the class.
So right now, what I would like to do is introduce our speaker for today's lecture, Introduction to the Scientific Study of Psychic Phenomena. Dr. Carlos S. Alvarado received his BA in psychology from the University of Puerto Rico, an MSc in parapsychology from John F. Kennedy University in California, an MA in history from Duke University, and a PhD in psychology from the University of Edinburgh. He is well known among scientific parapsychologists for his more than 250 articles in English and Spanish, published in, among others, the Journal of Psychology, Dissociation, the Journal of Parapsychology, and the Journal of the Society for Psychical Research. He was the first Latin American to be elected president of the Parapsychological Association and served two terms in that office in 1995 and again in 2002-2003. Dr. Alvarado holds an adjunct appointment at Sophia University, formerly the Institute of Transpersonal Psychology, and is assistant professor of research in psychiatry and neurobehavioral sciences at the Division of Perceptual Studies at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville, Virginia. He recently was appointed research fellow for the Parapsychology Foundation, with which he has been involved as a consultant, staff member, and volunteer since 1998. He is also currently a director of Alvarado, Zingroni & Associates, the co-founder and developer of the Alvarado Zingroni Institute for Research and Education in the Virtual World Second Life, the Facebook page, YouTube channel, and blog Parapsychology Online, and writes his own blog, Parapsychology, News History, and Research. And here is Dr. Alvarado.
Hello there. Hello, everyone. I hope you can hear me well and clear. If there's any problem, just please type and let us know. Good. Okay. Well, today I'm going to present a very general introduction to the topic of this course, which is parapsychology in general. What I will be doing, and let me show you my next, slides. This is the outline of my talk. I hope to basically present some definitions, identify some areas of the field, I'll say a little about history, but not too much. I generally do a lot of work on the history of parapsychology, but in this presentation, I'm going to avoid that area because that's a very big topic by itself. I want to say something about the phenomena that are studied, the methodology, the different approaches, and why is the field important. The point of this talk is not to summarize findings in the field of what we have learned about psychic phenomena, but just basically is to say what is parapsychology and how parapsychologists do their work. So you will hear a lot about methodology and approaches. That's kind of the main part. I hope that as we go through the course, you will get more details about specific phenomena and specific findings. We're going to hear about clinical issues, about methodological and some of the findings related to precognition research, and so many other topics. So a lot of the things that I will be discussing here will be covered in the course. But because there are so many aspects of parapsychology, the 20-something presentations that we have in the course are not enough to cover all the topics. So things such as poltergeist phenomena, we are going to receive very little discussion, and the same with out-of-body experiences and many other topics. A lot of those topics we hope to cover in future courses, but at least you will have an exposure to some of the main issues of the field, or at least some of the issues of the field. Let me move on and then start properly. How do we define parapsychology? I have never been comfortable or happy with any single definition of parapsychology. I like to use the term just as to cover a general field that uses the scientific method to study what we call psychic phenomena, and I will later mention some of those phenomena. As you can see in these slides, there are many possible ways to define parapsychology, and each of them has a particular bias, you could say, or a particular emphasis, that perhaps is a better word. So in the first definition, the emphasis is more on the variety of different explanations. So it's a discipline that is trying to explain all kinds of phenomena, be this through fraud, illusion, or by the use of classic or new psychological functions. Other people, just as J.B. Ryan, emphasize the concept of non-physicality as a main definition of parapsychology. And here is Ryan and Pratt from the book Parapsychology, published in 1957, defining the field as the branch of inquiry which deals with non-physical personal operations or phenomena. So the issue of non-physicality, which some people use to refer to spirituality, is the main criteria for the definition of the field for these authors. But not everyone agrees with that, because in many ways that's a very theory-laden definition, and a lot of people are not convinced of the validity of the idea of non-physicality as applied to parapsychology. So as you can see, there are other approaches, other concepts used to define the parapsychology. The next one focuses on phenomena outside accepted boundaries, and I hope you will read the definitions by yourself. And the final one that I have here that comes from Italy, from a book by Biondi and Tresoldi, the whole criteria here is the issue of the mind connecting directly with the world. So as you can see, there is no generally acceptable definition of parapsychology, and some of the definitions really are very different from each other. Some of these authors will not agree with each other. But I think everyone will agree with the issue that what parapsychology is a discipline that is scientific, that is scholarly, that tries to use all kinds of approaches, mainly scientific ones, to study a group of phenomena. And in that way, it's very similar to psychology and to many other academic disciplines. But at this point, we don't have a generally acceptable definition. Excuse me. There are many areas in parapsychology, and again, the classification of the areas is as subjective as the definitions that I just covered. On one hand, as you can see on the right-hand side, you can define the areas in terms of methods, experiments, or the study of cases, for example. In terms of approaches, quantitative or qualitative parts of the field. In terms of disciplinary emphasis, psychological, physical, sociological approaches, or in terms of the phenomena themselves. So you could classify it in many other ways. Another option I present here to the left is the whole issue of agency. where do the phenomena come from or are believed to come from? Such as, you know, the phenomena that are experienced by human beings, but then there are other phenomena that are experienced or maybe produced by animals. Which is very much underdeveloped in our field. And then the phenomena suggestive of survival of death. Traditionally, from the beginnings of organized psychical research, and in the parapsychology was known before the temporal psychology became more popular, there was a lot of interest in the issue of do human beings survive bodily death? And there has been an area of parapsychology still active today that tries to address that issue empirically, studying cases of mediums, recollections of previous lives, and many other phenomena. So as you can see, there are many ways also of classifying the areas of the field that vary widely. We are covering in this course both parapsychology and anomalistic psychology. We should be aware that anomalistic psychology includes wider topics than parapsychology, such as the ones that you see here. Anomalistic psychology focuses on paranormal beliefs, outer states of consciousness, hypnosis, and many of the other things that you see listed there. Parapsychologists do not study directly those phenomena. They are concerned with all of those things as they relate to what they define as a psychic phenomena. Of course, the interaction between both fields is kind of more complex than that. And anomalistic psychology, like parapsychology, has different definitions. You will hear from people that will say that to be anomalistic psychology, you have to use only conventional explanations. That is, you will not consider something paranormal, some new principle of communication, like what people talk about when they refer to ESP. Anomalistic psychologists will say, no, we don't think that there is any new form of communication from mind to mind, for example, or to see the future, but all these phenomena can be explained through principles that we already know, such as sensory cues, coincidence, and many other similar things, or by extending what we know about the conventional, which is what basically science accepts today. There will be more discussion of this later on. Christine Simmons-Moore is going to present a very interesting presentation about her book with other authors called Anomalistic Psychology, which you see here in this slide. And not only will she summarize the content of the book, but she will get into these issues that I just mentioned. What is anomalistic psychology? What is parapsychology? How do they interact? And I will remind you again that the boundaries are not very clear set and that there are different groups that define things differently. I said I was not going to get into history, but at least I have one slide that I would like to cover really fast to give you an idea about where is parapsychology coming from. At the bottom, you see modern parapsychology, excuse me, that is characterized by laboratory and many other types of studies with a predominance of laboratory statistical studies. But as you can see, and I'm sorry, some of the things in this slide move slightly. The things come from antiquity. You know, psychic phenomena, of course, are known since the beginning of humankind. There's so many records coming from antiquity, much before the 18th century, which is where I start here. You know, you hear talks about the ancient oracles, even ancient cases of mediumship and the like. And through the years, there have been different movements, different conceptual frameworks that have attempted to explain psychic phenomena and have put them in a very specific theoretical framework. So we see, as you can see by the second arrow, the movement of mesmerism, which I'm afraid you cannot read clearly in this slide. A lot of psychic phenomena there were conceptualized as the result of a universal force that was called animal magnetism and that permeated the whole of nature, human bodies as well. And by channeling and harnessing that energy, you could induce trances, but you could also induce healings. You could cause the phenomena that today we refer to as ESP. And that became very popular in the 18th century, by the end of the 18th century, and most of the 19th century. And again, that combining with other different, such as the later movement of spiritualism, with the main idea of making contacts with the dead, mediumship was a concept that developed widely in spiritualism, although it was already known in the mesmeric movement and also in antiquity. But all those movements interacting with each other, proceeding and following, but also interacting at the same time, make popular the claims of psychic phenomena and eventually lead us to psychical research in the 19th century, an important moment being the founding of the Society for Psychical Research in 1882, where a lot of systematic experiments in telepathy or studies, case studies in telepathy, studies of mediumship, a lot of those phenomena are started in the 19th century to be studied more systematically. Even though, again, they have been observed and recorded and sometimes studied quite in quite interesting ways before that period. Eventually, that leads to modern parapsychology, but in between, as you can see by all these arrows I have here, there is a lot of interaction with many other movements. So psychical research affected and was affected by psychology and psychiatry, which in the 19th century was both psychology and psychiatry were developing, were very active into carving a space in academia for themselves and developing ideas such as the concept of the subconscious mind or ideas of dissociation, particularly in terms of dissociative pathology, things such as double and multiple personalities, which later changed their names, but were very much the center of attention of a lot of physicians and philosophers and psychologists in that period. All those ideas affect psychical research very much, but psychical research also contributes to those observations by presenting phenomena such as automatic writing that shows the existence of a non. Again, this is just a very, very brief historical development. Certainly, there are many other things in between that I have not mentioned, but I just wanted to get a flavor of it. This is really not the emphasis of what I wanted to discuss today. So, okay, what are we studying in parapsychology? What is the subject matter? And I will say something also about what is not the subject matter. Well, two main aspects are what we call extrasensory perception and psychokinesis. Excuse me. In extrasensory perception, the idea is that we acquire information about our environment, about people around us, about events that are happening. Generally, you can talk about three types of ESP: telepathy, clairvoyance, precognition. Telepathy is when you get ideas that other people are having, but it could also be their thoughts, their emotions, basically the mental aspect of other people's lives. So you can feel if someone is feeling really depressed or is thinking about a particular topic. Clairvoyance tends to refer in general, also these distinctions can become quite academic and in real life are very hard to maintain, but clairvoyance is technically used to refer to the ESP of events, separate perhaps from the perception of a human being. So instead of getting someone's thought, you get the objective reality around that person. If there is a car accident, you theoretically you may perceive the actual crash of a car with another. But you could also be perceiving, and this will be classified as telepathy, the thoughts of the person at the time of the car crash. Obviously, we have no way of making at this point a difference between both telepathy and clairvoyance in a situation just like that. That's what I was saying, that in practical terms, you really cannot make a difference between one and the other. And even experimentally, where you can manipulate conditions, it's very difficult really to do this. We talk about precognition when we are referring to information about the future. So ESP in general is acquiring information. I'm sure many of you are familiar with these old very basic ideas, but we feel that it's necessary for those of you that are not into this literature to at least know some of the super basics, so that later on when you get the other talks in the course, which will be really much more advanced, you will know what they're talking about. We also talk about psychokinesis, which is instead of perceiving things, you are affecting them physically, or at least that's how they have been proposed over the years. Because remember, all these classifications are always artificial, and you can argue that it really even doesn't make much sense to talk about these differences. But in terms of analyzing the phenomena, they can be helpful. So the environment is affected in psychokinesis, popularly called the mind over matter, and there are many examples over the years of people being able to affect objects, such as making objects move, or a table in the context of seances, you know, in spiritualism. You see that tables move, they levitate, they float in the air. That will be an example of psychokinesis on objects. But there are also examples of what we call here biological organisms. There have been experiments where people try to affect the growth of plants or wounds in the body of people or animals. That obviously has a lot of implications for the idea of healing. And then all kinds of other things, such as electrical and mechanical systems, all kinds of machines that have been constructed to test for psychokinesis, some of them from very simple, others are much more complex and are basically computerized devices. But the whole idea is that something is affected. We really don't know how to explain these things. You know, ideas go from simple physical energies, like, you know, electromagnetism, to all kinds of other processes that assume non-physicality, or for others assume ideas of non-locality, basically that they are not physical in the classic way, or in the way that common people define it. You know, it's something that they cannot see, that they cannot measure too easily. But the reality is that conceptually speaking, we cannot explain this phenomena yet. We have ideas about how they may work. There are models that are being proposed. We will hear, for example, Ed May and Sonali Marwaha talking about precognition and a physical model that they have about precognition. That's what we want to do in parapsychology, develop ideas that are not only rich conceptually, but that can be studied empirically, which is the whole point of parapsychology. We don't want to continue talking and bringing ideas like you see generally in philosophy and other fields, that is a question of discussing ideas of possibilities. Yeah, we need possibilities, but we also need to do something with them. We need to test them empirically. We need to find evidence to see if those things are really happening, or if we need to modify or even reject our theory. Some of the things that we believe we have learned about ESP is the whole idea that they are connected with the unconscious mind. You can see here in the quote from Ryan and Pratt that they use the term psi, which is a general term to include ESP and psychokinesis. Some people use it for psychic phenomena in general, but they argue that psi is an unconscious function. And the idea that ESP, for example, is processed in the unconscious mind is kind of very old. From the 19th century on, Frederick Myers was talking about it. Frederick Myers was a classical scholar and psychologist, one of the founders of the Society for Psychical Research in London in the 19th century. And he was already discussing all these ideas of the importance of the unconscious mind, which he referred to as the subliminal mind. It was quite different from the unconscious mind of Freud and many other later theorists. But as you can see with all these arrows, some of them move a little out of place, there have been other people in history that have had similar ideas. Coming to our own days, where James Carpenter, which has proposed a fascinating model of psi functioning, one of the issues is that these things are unconscious. So this is one of the things believed to be one of the discoveries by way of investigation relates to this phenomenon. We have also learned some things about the expression of ESP. Excuse me. And generally, you know, people talk about vehicles or the forms of manifestation. Here, the work of Loaiza Ryan has been very influential. She started from the 1950s on to study cases that she received, people that were having dreams and other experiences in daily life. And she basically classified the way ESP manifested, which was not new with her at all. These classifications existed in slightly different ways from the 19th century. But she talked about dreams, about intuitions, about hallucinations. And the whole idea was that ESP is you acquire information via ESP. And she didn't know how that happened. We still don't know. And that can be expressed in the form of an intuition or a hallucination. You have a vision of something happening. So you get information about someone having an accident, and you may see in front of you the face of the person that had the accident, that kind of thing. The more common ones were dreams, and as she classified them, they were literal and symbolic dreams. Symbolic, obviously, refer to dreams that are expressed in different types of symbols. So, you know, if a symbol of death could be a black bird or a skeleton or something like that. And you see a skeleton passing by in a dream, and that may be related to the concept of death or to something else. The point is that ESP expresses itself in all these different ways that you see in the slide. And, of course, in many more. In experimental work, some of which is being carried right now as we speak, we have physiological measurements, and there is good evidence, I think, that people can acquire knowledge that they're not conscious of, but that expresses through physiological changes, such as changes in heart rate or blood pressure or other things of that sort. So the whole idea is that ESP can be expressed in a variety of different ways, sometimes more direct than others. Again, some of the things that we have learned is that in precognition, which is an ESP for about future events, is expressed very frequently in dreams. What you see in this slide are basically collections of cases that have been from the 19th century to the 50s. And you see the high percent of dreams in terms of precognition. So one of the things that we have learned is that a lot of the precognitions reported tend to come in dreams. Why that is the case, that's a matter of speculation, but it has been argued, you know, that dreams is a more direct a state that connects us more directly to the unconscious, that sometimes people resist the concept of seeing the future because for a lot of people that's an impossibility. But when you're in a dreaming state, you don't need to analyze things rationally. You're not awake, so you can tolerate some of those things that in the waking state will be much harder to deal with. And so the idea of getting information about the future may be easier to handle in a dream. Again, that, those are speculations, but it's one of the things that we have learned about so many others about ESP. And of course, experiments, and I will talk a little later about experiments and surveys and case studies of different sources, have also taught us many different things about ESP, such as there seems to be a relationship with altered states of consciousness, you know, things like hypnosis, or when you are kind of in a twilight state between waking and awake and sleeping, that alterations of consciousness favor the appearance of ESP. And there is a lot of work done on it. What we need at this point is more work to explore the actual reasons of that and the actual mechanism. But we have a lot of information also about many other things, such as extraversions, extroverted people doing better in many of the ESP tasks. Believe in ESP. When you believe that ESP is real and can happen, you tend to do better in experimental studies. And of course, this makes sense. You know, when you are convinced of something, you have a positive attitude about something, you can deal with it better. When you are negative and about something and you have to do a task, any type of task, everything becomes harder. And it could be that, cognitively speaking, you know, belief kind of open barriers and makes things more accessible from the unconscious to the conscious mind. But again, I will say again, this is only a speculation. The actual reasons for these relationships are really not well understood at all. That's why we need to continue to do research. Another topic, leaving the issue of ESP, is that of apparitions. It could be related to ESP. It could be something completely different. It's a matter of theoretical preference. So in psychical research and now in modern parapsychology, we see studies of apparitions of the dead and apparitions of the living. Of the dead are those of people that have died, and you see them appear. Sometimes it's just a flash of a person. Sometimes they stay and even convey messages. And of course, this has direct relevance to the issue of survival of death. And apparitions of the living is another fascinating type of case that is kind of less known than those of apparitions of the dead. And now when you see the form of a person appearing just in front of you, but that person is alive. And many times it will be alive after your experience. You tend to see some of those, some cases are related to what we call crisis, where the person is dying, is ill, is in an accident, something bad is happening to the person, and the perceiver has the experience. But there are many different types of apparitions of the living as well. It's a fascinating phenomenon. And the apparitions seen in many other different contexts, the so-called deathbed visions, when someone is in the process of dying, many times are reported that they see figures of the dead, usually family members or friends. That's a form of apparition, but in a very different context. People that have near-death experiences sometimes see spirits, spiritual entities around them. That could be considered also a form of apparitions. It's a very wide phenomena that happens in many, many forms and in different contexts. And it's a traditionally from the 19th century, there has been a lot of systematic work about it. In more recent times, this is an example. Erlendur Haraldsson, a psychologist from Iceland, published fairly recently this book, The Departed Among the Living, which is based on cases that he collected in Iceland. The various cases of apparitions, excuse me, in this case, apparitions of the dead. And you can see some of the things he tried to find out were the patterns in the cases. So he found that 28% of those that appear died in a violent way. And that's compared to 8% of violent deaths in the general Icelandic population. I was trying to make the point that apparitions have a much higher rate of violent death than what is generally reported. But he also documented a lot of features of apparitions, you know, how are they seen? Do they seem solid? Do they talk to people? All kinds of fascinating things. Parapsychologists have been involved in this for a long time. The same can be said about haunting apparitions, which are cases of apparitions that are recurrent. The same or presumably the same apparition is seen in the same place or the same area repeatedly over time. This is like the case of the Cheltenham ghost, which is originally reported in 1892 in the Proceedings of the Society for Psychical Research, is still to this day one of the most interesting cases of haunting. And it was very well documented. And a lot of people in this particular house and outside of the house will see a figure like the one that you see here in this slide. So this is also a form of apparition that has engaged the interest of psychical researchers over time. But so is the phenomenon of mediumship. Well, again, this is one of the main phenomena dealing with the issue of survival of bodily death. Mediums are people that are believed to produce phenomena via the agency of spirits of the dead. Basically, that they are channeling, they're bringing the influence of spirits of the dead in different ways. In the mental ways, we talk about mental mediumship, or physical manifestations, physical mediumship. The mental mediumship, the medium will speak, will write, will have visions, and some of the other things you see in this slide that will convey information. Usually it's a message from someone that a seer that is consulting the medium wants to know about. So a seer will come to a medium, and the medium will hear a voice, and they will say, I hear the answer to your question, and they give the answer. In some of the best mediums studied over many years in parapsychology, veridical information has been obtained, basically meaning that what the mediums are saying was verified by the seer. You know, you give names, accounts of specific events that happen in a family, or those things can turn out to be true. But sometimes those things are imparted in writing or in other ways. Physical mediumship is, again, both interact, both mental and physical mediumship are not completely separate. Many physical mediums are also mental. So the manifestations can appear, two types of manifestation can appear in the same individual. But when we talk about physical mediumship, we're talking about things such as raps, movement of objects. Raps are sounds. Sometimes that you hear like someone delivering blows on a table or on a wall, and all kinds of other things, such as photography of spirits, like the one you see here on to the left, or the phenomenon of materializations, which is probably the most controversial phenomenon of mediumship, where forms appear in a seance room that are tangible. You know, people can touch them, and they can feel that they are solid, and their appearance ranges from the well-formed to the not-so-well-formed. And again, a lot of these phenomena are very difficult to study. And unfortunately, there is also a long history of fraud in the production of different ones. So you have to evaluate each case carefully. This is just to give you an example of a medium that died not so long ago. I think this is Chico Xavier from Brazil. I think he died around 2002 or something like that. He was extremely well known in Brazil, and he was a mental medium. And this is a case of his automatic writing. You know, he will just sit and will write something. Sometimes he will write with both hands. And using that writing that he and others claim came from spirits, he wrote many, many books that were published about all kinds of topics. stories about people's lives from the old days or about philosophical issues, all kinds of things. Well, here is an example of his writing, which is mirror writing. It's kind of written backwards. So this is just to show you that in recent times, these things are still happening and are still happening all around. And probably all of you are from different countries, and I'm sure in each one of your countries, this type of phenomena, someone is engaging in producing it. This is another example. This is Eileen Garrett in a trance. This is a photograph from the 1930s. And basically, she's trying to communicate with what people in that house believe were entities that were living in the house. This is part of the job of the medium, to communicate and help spirits. And the issue here is that this was a case of a house believed to be haunted. And she was brought here, as many people do with mediums, to try to see if they could understand the cause of the haunting and try to see if by using a medium to communicate with those supposed entities, they could either stop the haunting or at least understand it. Again, this is another thing that mediums have done over the years, and there have been use of mediums in this way and in similar ways for investigation over the years. Another phenomena, and again, I apologize here, I'm jumping from one phenomena to the other, but I just want you to give a very panoramic view of some of these things that are studied in parapsychology. Out-of-body experiences, just the experience where that people feel that they leave their physical body and they perceive their environment from a location outside the body. The illustration that you see here is kind of like an artist's conception of the out-of-body experiences of Sylvan Muldoon, which is an old astral projector that was writing at the end of the 1920s and in later years about his experiences. What you see here is a basic question that many surveys have asked, trying to find out how many people have out-of-body experiences in different places. Well, here I have an interesting slide from one of my studies of out-of-body experiences. I'm sorry that some of these numbers move around, but these are cases that I compiled when I was doing my PhD thesis in Scotland, and I basically was asking people via newspapers and magazines if they could send me accounts of out-of-body experiences. And I ended with about 80-something reports, and these are some of the interesting things that they reported. Like 71% had floating sensations, 69% stayed in the usual surroundings, 65% saw their physical body, and so forth. You know, these are only some of the most frequent features in my study, but there have been many other studies, and certainly there are many similarities between these studies, such as seeing the physical body is quite common. Here I found 65%, but as you can see, it's not universal. There are many cases still that do not have that feature. And the same can be said about a variety of other features. There are hundreds of different features, and in fact, many studies fail to document a lot of features of the out-of-body experience, particularly some of them that are more rare. You know, there are some that when you try to measure them, only 2-3% of people have them. But the challenge of the investigation is to see how much you can document the existence of these features and then try to study the conditions in which they appear, the type of person that has the particular features, and so on. It's a very complicated topic, that there is a lot of literature on this that I cannot get into now. But I think I just want to give you the idea that the whole point is not only to be purely descriptive, as what you see in this study, but to try to do a lot of analysis that will relate the out-of-body experience to other variables, other issues, and then we will learn more about why certain things happen the way they happen, what type of person has them, and so forth. It is one of those areas that is very much connected with the occult literature, in which you can find fascinating ideas about the occurrence of this phenomenon. Another phenomenon is poltergeists, which are basically spontaneous physical manifestations that take place around a particular individual. Excuse me. It's time to take a drink here. Some examples are movement of objects and wraps, but as you can see in the next slide, and I'm sorry the percents really move around here, this is a study of 116 published poltergeist cases from William Rawls' chapter in the Handbook of Parapsychology that appeared in 1977. And here, basically, he tried to show what were the most common phenomena and features of poltergeist in these 116 cases. Certainly, this is not all the poltergeist cases in the world, but it's a good sample. You know, many of them are cases that have been well investigated over the years. So the movement of objects, 91%, sounds of different sorts, 54%, and the sounds can vary. They can be just like sounds that seem to come from an object, you know, like if someone was hitting a table or a wall, to other types of sounds. Apparitions that were seen, and as you can see, there are many other effects. These are fascinating cases that are part of what we call field studies in parapsychology. And again, like with out-of-body experiences and many other phenomena, you can do a lot with these cases, either with single cases or with group of cases, to study their patterns, to study their... But the first step, of course, is to find out if the phenomena are real. If when people in a house will say things are moving around, you try to find out if their testimony is credible, how many people have seen it, can you establish, you know, good evidence that those things happen? And in cases that are still active, if you can get to the place, you try to find out if you can make observations by yourself, basically to see if the things are really happening. And then the second step is try to do other types of tests to find something about the nature of the movements, you know, what type of objects are affected, how often do they happen, and so forth. Auras is another phenomena that has been very much neglected in parapsychology, but is something that a lot of psychics report, and that is very much around us. It's very much related to healing practices. What you see here on the right-hand side is a research paper that Nancy and I and Natasha Aji did together, and it's basically a study of psychological aspects of seeing auras. We're trying to relate seeing auras to things such as dissociations and other psychic experiences, and we actually found very, very strong correlations between the people that saw auras and this other phenomena. Recollections of previous lives, I believe someone was mentioned the work of Ian Stevenson. Here you have Ian Stevenson on the left and some of his books. Basically, he has been studying children that remember or claim to remember previous lives. And one of the things he has found is that some of the main aspects of the cases, and these are not the only ones, but some of the main ones are what you see here in the slides, they make statements about recollections. They say, I used to be such and such, and I live in a village and my name was, and they give a name, and they give details about their lives. If they were married, if they had children, if they owned property. Those were the verbal statements. And Stevenson has been able to corroborate a lot of these things. You know, he puts on record all the statements of the child and then tries to investigate to find out if someone that fits those descriptions or that information really existed. And in the best of cases, he finds that a lot of that information can be corroborated. But the children also show other fascinating things, such as behaviors that are consistent with our previous lives. So they have phobias, you know, intense fears of things that are sometimes related to the way that they died in the previous life. So a child now that has a very strong fear of water, the story may go that he died by drowning in a local river or in some other way. There are also some talents that some of the children, or taste, likes and dislikes that some of the children show. All of this Stevenson tries to document, and tries, the whole idea is to try to see if what the child now is remembering and or showing in terms of behaviors was characteristics of that person that is dead now but existed and lived in a different place a few years before or just a few months before. So in some of the cases, you get birthmarks and birth defects in the children now that correspond to problems that the children, that the person had been in the previous lives, or sometimes that are related to the way the person died. It varies. But the whole point is that in addition to actual memories or behaviors, there are also these physiological aspects like birth defects or birthmarks that seem to be passed from one life to the other. And the challenge in Stevenson's research is first to document that and then try to show if there are possible normal explanations or not, and how to classify all of that in a way that may be consistent with the idea of a previous life. And that's no easy task, because a lot of these cases happen in places such as India or many other Asian countries, so you have to travel to small villages. And the other patterns that Stevenson has found, basically he goes to all these places and he interviews the child's family, the family of the previous personality, and many other witnesses. In some cases, there is not much to go on, but in most of the cases that he has published, they can be quite impressive with a lot of details showing that something is really going on. And you can see here some of the publications that he has had. He's no longer with us. He died a few years back, but the work is still being continued. And it's a very important, you know, area of research. But it's unfortunate that only very few people in parapsychology do this type of research, which falls into the area of survival of death. There are, of course, many other phenomena, and I'm not going to say much more about them, but, you know, you can see dowsing, like you see in the illustration here, which is looking for water or minerals that are under the earth, usually holding a twig, or sometimes it's a metal bar, or there are many different ways of doing it. And, you know, people walk around, and when the thing they're holding kind of points to the place, and in some of them, you know, it seems to have a life on their own, especially with people that have a lot of experience. You try to find if the place pointed, that's where the water or the mineral you're looking for is. Again, this is one of those areas. There is a long history, but there are not so many, not so much systematic research. Healing, that you will be hearing later, I will not say more, Daniel Bennor will be talking about it. Near-death experiences, materializations, luminous effects, photographic effects of different sorts. There are all kinds of strange physical phenomena, excuse me, that are related, that are part of parapsychology, Many of these things, again, don't receive much investigation. Materialization phenomena, which was a big in the 19th century with mediums, and also came into the 20th. It's still with us today. There's still mediums that do these things. There have been many studies about it, but in terms of systematic studies right now, there is very little. You know, you find a lot of websites claiming and big things and presenting all kinds of photographs and a lot of enthusiasts that are always defending these things, but you see very little in terms of systematic investigations that pay attention to methodology, which is the whole issue of parapsychology. If you don't have that behind your studies or your claims, then it's a big problem and it's very difficult to evaluate from the scientific point of view. If you are not interested in the scientific point of view, that's a different thing. There are a lot of other unexplained phenomena that generally are not considered a part of parapsychology, such as psychological phenomena like we mentioned before, like hallucinations, hypnosis, other things, dreams. Psychic information may come through dreams, but dreams by themselves are not part of the things that parapsychology study. The same about different practices, systems, such as acupuncture, yoga, many others. That's also not part of parapsychology, but it may be very much related, and it may be used to understand psychic phenomena. Strange creatures, you know, we study apparitions or things like that, but we don't study the Loch Ness creature or claims of Bigfoot or so on. A lot of people, you know, tend to confuse a lot of these other phenomena with the subject matter of parapsychology. The same with UFOs. UFOs have points of contact with psychic phenomena, but to study, you know, spaceships or encounters or abductions is really not considered by most people part of parapsychology. Some people will disagree with this, but in general, you will not see studies of these things in almost any parapsychology journal or in the scientific parapsychology conventions. So researchers have basically, that's how they define, by exclusion, is how they define what is part of the field. It does not mean that these are not important phenomena. It does not mean that they are not real. That's not the issue. But there are limits about the whole point is that not everything strange or anomalous or weird is part of parapsychology. And I give the example, it's kind of a humorous one, of the famous Mr. Ed. I don't know, some of you that are not from the United States may not be familiar with Mr. Ed. It's an old American TV show of a horse that was intelligent and could talk. And again, this is something that is one of these strange creature reports. I put it here mainly as a joke, but it also brings the point that there are many claims, some of them quite strange, that are not necessarily studied by parapsychologists. But I will say that everything that you see here, perhaps even Mr. Ed, deserves serious study. You know, any phenomenon that says something about the human mind, about behavior, deserves study. If it's part of parapsychology or not, that's a different issue. Okay, let's say a little about methodology, and that's a very very important thing in parapsychology. How do we study the phenomena? Well, as you can see, I classify it generally under laboratory, studies of cases, and other forms of research. Inside each of them, you'll see all that there are varieties. Let me go very fast through some of them. Some of the experiments, which basically experiments are conducted in a laboratory, which is a place where you try to bring the phenomena to a place, say a person that says that they can perceive the thoughts of someone else. You bring them into the lab, you put the person in one room, you put another person in another room and try to mentally send or have the intention of sending mental images to this person that they're isolated. So you are trying to induce, to provoke the phenomena in a controlled environment. The correlational experiments, by that we mean studies that show relationship between phenomena. By that means you show ESP in the laboratory and you try to see if shy people do better or worse than extroverted. And you classify them people, you know, you do the ESP study and you ask them information to see if you can classify them as shy or extroverted. And later on, you correlate or you try to relate the scores of ESP that are mentioned, measured in a quantitative way, statistically, to the variables of shyness or extroversion or whatever else. What you get is a relationship, but you cannot claim that there is any cause and effect between the other. And this is a topic that can get quite technical and complicated, but it's just important to keep in mind that just because you show in the laboratory a relationship between a psychic phenomenon and something else, that doesn't mean that something else is causing the ESP or psychokinesis or whatever. It just means that it's a factor in the production of the psychic manifestation. But this is a way in which we deal in the laboratory with this phenomena. Another form of experimentation is what some psychologists used to call the true experiments, and that is where you really manipulate a variable to affect your dependent variable. In this case, something like ESP will be what you're trying to measure. So you measure a group of people's ESP scores, and you know who did well and who did not. But if you want to manipulate the situation, you take half of your people, say you divided 40 people into a group of 20 and another group of 20, and in one group, you basically give them a beer to drink, basically to see if alcohol will affect ESP scores. But to the other group, you do not give any alcohol. And by that, you are starting to manipulate the thing, and you are trying to show if the introduction of alcohol makes a difference in the ESP scores. You are trying to be more active within the experiment. You can do more, such as do random assignment of people. There are many other ways to do a very well controlled experiment. But the idea is that there are some experiments that control more than others. And that's just the general point that I want to present to you now. Moving on into cases, we have what we call case collections, which is a very simple method, but very important also. That means you collect many cases. You're interested in precognition in dreams. You collect 200 cases of dreams that have precognitive elements. Or you can collect near-death experiences, out-of-body experiences, whatever the phenomena is, you collect it. I mean, they are just accounts that you are getting from people, so you don't have any control. You can put appeals of cases in newspapers, in radio stations. Now, of course, you can do things online, and you can get, in a few months, you could get hundreds or maybe even thousands of cases. Some people form collections out of cases that they have received because they become famous. Loaiza Ryan was a case in point. She was at the J.B. Ryan's Parapsychology Laboratory, and the place was so well known that they started receiving thousands of letters of people reporting their things, their dreams, their intuitions, things of that sort. So she put them all together, and she made many fascinating studies of that material. You could also use published cases. You can collect cases any way you want. Of course, there are sometimes problems with some forms of collection, but that's a weakness sometimes of the method. One example published in 1970 is Ian Stevenson's book, Telepathic Impressions, which was an analysis of veridical, or recall veridical imageless experiences. People had thoughts, they had feelings, they have emotions, sometimes they have physical symptoms about something that related to a distant event. So feeling really bad at the time that someone close to you died at a distance and you did not know what that person had died in any way. So he collected, you know, a lot of cases. In the analysis that I present here, what he did is that he got his own cases, 35 cases, or before that, he got more than 100 cases from published sources. And he analyzed it, like, following these ideas, you know, like, what was the topic about? Was it about a dying person? He reported 41%. About someone ill or accident, 41% as well, and so forth. He did all kinds of fascinating analysis. This is just one example, again, of very useful form of research, but also there are a lot of issues that are not controlled at all, that are beyond your control, because you're depending on what people choose to write to you, what they're telling you. You can follow it up, you can contact them and get more information. But this is the issue, that each of the approaches that we're talking here about are good for some things and are very weak for others. The same applies to the experimental method. A lot of control in some aspects, and you can be more sure that what you're dealing with cannot be explained normally because it happens under your own conditions. But at the same time, you also lose the natural aspect of the case. You know, it's very hard in the lab to deal with the motivations and needs of participants. So everything has its pros and minuses. The single case studies is another approach. Some people have studied specific cases, and these are some examples of a little old cases. There are not so many of these type of studies today, but you still see reports here and there. There are some examples published in the Journal of the Society for Psychical Research of single cases referring to precognitive dreams, people that have a dream about some future event, sometimes dealing with disasters. A lot of these type of precognitions are very negative things. And the role of the researcher is basically to try to document the case, try to find some corroboration, try to find information about the details of the dream. You know, some dreams are symbolic, others are not. So some dreams have very strong imagery, others the imagery is not that strong. And so you have to go through each of the cases, as these people did here, and try to present them. The idea is that after many of these cases have been accumulated, then you can do studies of groups of cases. Another approach that, again, is dealing with cases out there is that of surveys, where you basically get information from a group of people and you ask them the same question, usually through a questionnaire. So you go to a lecture, and the lecture has 600 people sitting there. You give them the questionnaire asking the same questions to those 600 people. In other studies, when you want to get information considered to be representative of the general population, you use random sampling. You use several techniques that have been developed by sociologists and others to collect information, and you mail. Through the mail, you send out a lot of questionnaires to addresses of people that you have randomly selected, or you can do it in many different ways. Now there is a lot of use of the web to do online surveys that certainly are not random and depend on the people that want to answer it, that are available. So also it has its problems. But it also has its advantage. You can get a lot of data and you can find interesting patterns that later on may inspire further research. And here you see some examples of surveys. One that has been extremely influential in modern times is the middle one, John Palmer's 1979 study, A Community Male Survey of Psychic Experiences. Well, this basically started the modern era in parapsychology of survey studies. There have been surveys done before, of course. Even from the 19th century in the SPR, they did some survey work. But in modern times, this study really set the methodologies and the type of things that a lot of people afterwards in the 1980s and 90s and even up today started asking. And what he was doing here was asking about the basic psychic experiences like ESP, out-of-body experiences, things like that. And also about many other things such as lucid dreams and dream recall and practice of meditation, and try to see if there were relationships between all those different experiences. And that's exactly what he found, and people coming after him found many similar things. So they found that one of the things he found is that if you have a high frequency of dream recall, you also have a high report of psychic experiences, you know, of ESP experiences, of seeing apparitions and the like. And so that opened this new area, which is a very psychological form of research, relating different types of experiences to each other. These are more specific studies that, in a way, are following on John Palmer's initial work, that basically found that a lot of these psychic experiences were related to the variables that you see here, like dissociative experiences, hypnotic susceptibility, fantasy proneness. These are psychological constructs that are studied by cognitive and other types of psychologists, and basically are allowing us to relate the report of psychic experiences to other types of human experiences. Which is very important, because this is one of the things that people use to show that psychic phenomena are not that strange or weird, really. They are related to all kinds of psychological functioning. And if that is the case, then perhaps we are dealing with something that is very human, which is what a lot of people believe. This is a particular example of a survey that I was involved with. And this is a questionnaire that was published in a New Age and Psychic magazine published in Spain. This cover here, this is one issue of this magazine. So it's a glossy magazine that has thousands and thousands of subscribers. It goes all around Spain. And one of the things that we found that was not surprising, other people have also found, but we wanted to study it in this particular group that had very high rates of psychic experiences. We found that interrelationships between all of these psychic phenomena, so people that saw apparitions also tended, in general, not 100%, to have out-of-body experiences, to see auras, to have ESP. If you had dream ESP, you will also see auras. That's the general pattern that the surveys like this have shown, and again bring the study of psychic experience into the realm of psychology. This I will go over because it's basically the same point. Field studies, which are studies in a particular location, this is another approach to study cases. People basically go to the place where the things are happening. The photo that you see here is Ian Stevenson investigating a reincarnation case. This is probably in India. I don't know where exactly, but he will be there physically and will question people, will interview everyone he could and gather information. You can do the same with poltergeist cases, that you go to the place, you interview everyone, and if the case is still active, you can then try to observe it yourself, maybe even set some quasi-experimental situations, you know, situations in which you put certain objects in certain places to see if they are affected in the poltergeist case. Another approach, and again, I'm flying through all of these, is a bibliographical one in which people use published materials, something that I mentioned before. An example was William Rawls' study of poltergeist, a study that I published in 1987 of luminous phenomena that people will say happen around the human body, similar to auras, perhaps the same thing, but sometimes seen by several different people. Basically, what I did there is I went through the literature of mediums, saints, dying people, and took out many cases and tried to make sense out of them. Sometimes it's very hard because you may have hundreds of cases. I didn't have that many. But what you try to do is find patterns, trying to find out if the descriptions are similar, if the context in which they happen, such as do cases reported with dying persons are similar or different to those reported with mediums, that kind of question. But again, it's a whole different approach. And there are many other approaches that are grouped under qualitative research. Qualitative research is basically focused on the meaning and the interpretation of the experience that people that have experience have. So a lot of the times, qualitative approaches are not really to prove that anything really happened, but to find out how did the person perceive what happened to them, how did they interpret it, how did the phenomena affected them. And, you know, people do interviews, participant observations, or analysis of text or language or the like. And as you can see, some examples here have been precognitive dreams have been studied like that, mediumship, a very recent paper, near-death experiences, you name it, and as long as there is a human being involved, you can apply any of these approaches. This is a much more complicated topic, but I don't have the time to get into it. But just to give you a flavor of a lot of the different ways in which these things are studied. Another one that is similar to the bibliographic approach, you basically go to publish experimental data, and it's basically a quantitative literature review. So you get a topic, say ESP or psychokinesis experiment, and you put all the experiments you can find together, and you try to find out if there is an overall effect. But basically, numerically, statistically speaking, all the experiments, when put together, support the existence of the phenomena. That's the more simple type of analysis. But you can do all kinds of things. You can find out if men and women perform differently over the 200 experiments that you were doing, and you can quantify that and do all kinds of even more complex interactions between the ESP or psychokinesis performance and whatever other variable you are interested in doing. A lot of these things started being done in the 1980s, and they are still being done today in all kinds of different phenomena. Let me say something then about approaches, which I have mentioned. Basically, the approach in parapsychology is that of this scientific method. Well, what parapsychology is trying to do is apply the scientific method, observation, defining problems, you propose hypotheses from your observations, and then you try to test your hypothesis. If you have observed something like, you know, apparitions or ESP, it seems to be more frequent in some places than the other, you try to do a study to test for that, in which if it's a place that is affecting the manifestation of the phenomena, you do studies in which you test people in a particular place compared to people in another place, and then try to see if a particular place, like a house environment, affects the phenomena. Or if it's a psychological variable, you gather people and you do those that are very high in fantasy, and then you test them for ESP, and you compare the high fantasy people against the low fantasy. And your hypothesis will be, you know, high fantasy people will be better in ESP scores. And you can either confirm or not that particular hypothesis. That's what hypothesis testing is basically about. And it can be done in the laboratory or in survey studies. It can be done in many different ways. But it's an empirical process. And that's very different from what you see here, that the whole point of parapsychology, like in science in general, you don't base your conclusions on issues such as personal experiences or opinions of others, psychic impressions, messages from the spirits, or all kinds of things like that. You basically try to do observations and test them using the tools of science. Of course, that doesn't mean that a lot of those things are not affecting you or are not useful. You can even say that you develop some of your hypotheses via the opinions of others and some of those other things. But in order to be science, you need to go back to the scientific method. And regardless if it was your own personal experience or something that a psychic told you, you use that to form a hypothesis, but you have to test that scientifically. You have to collect data, you have to analyze data, and find out if that can be supported or not. So that's a very important thing in parapsychology and the application of the scientific method in general. It also applies to psychology, to physics, to many other things. There are many ways in which we particularly learn about the phenomenon, many specific analyses, specific measurements that can be made to understand a little more about the phenomena in different ways. One of them is you study the features of the phenomena. One thing is to say people have near-death experiences. Another thing is to focus on the features of that phenomenon. The features are the characteristics. So you feel that you are at your body, you feel that you see a tunnel, you see lights, you experience all kinds of things. Those particular things are the features of the phenomena. So you not only find near-death cases, but you also find what are features of the NDE, of the near-death experience, people are experiencing. And then you go for interaction of features, like do people that are close to death have a different type of out-of-body experience from those that have the experience but not close to death? You know, some people are just riding a bicycle or walking around or dancing or just sitting down and have an out-of-body experience. But there are cases like that. Are those different? Are those out-of-body cases different from those where you are close to death? That's a way of doing interaction of features and learning more about the phenomena. The same about the circumstances of occurrence. You know, some people may be relaxing, others may be actively involved in some task. Do those things affect the incidence of the phenomena or even the other characteristics of the phenomena? We study how common the experience is. You know, some things in most of the surveys, auras usually come much lower than reports of ESP apparitions and out-of-body experiences. That doesn't mean that they are almost non-existent. They're still quite common. But almost all the surveys, and I have done comparisons of this, show us that. So some phenomena are more common than others. And when you put together a lot of studies, especially surveys, you find that out. Many of the laboratory studies have associated ESP to all kinds of other variables, such as psychological variables, personality characteristics, social variables, patterns of interaction, or physical variables. Some people have related it to geomagnetic activity. very important word, that of using physical variables, and I have not really gotten to that in this presentation. My orientation is more psychological, but the physical study of psychic phenomena is very important. And I think we're going to see a lot of developments of that, that will raise our understanding of this area, maybe more in the near future. And finally, you try to find causal relationships, which is very easy to say, but in practice it's very hard, because even in the best control experiments, we cannot control everything. And certainly, at the very least, we can find out what variables are more important. There are ways to weight the contribution of different variables and to find out which variable contributed more to a phenomenon. Like, let's say you are studying precognitive dreams, and you can measure all kinds of personality variables, and you can find that some of them are more important than others in the relationship, or as we say, in predicting the occurrence of a precognitive dream. And all that can be measured statistically or studied more qualitative way, but the whole point is to refine our knowledge and not only say, yes, psychological variables relate to psychic phenomena. You can find out which of those variables relate more and in what way. So again, these are issues, nuances that are very important in the scientific study of psychic phenomena. There are other issues of conceptual approaches, such as explanatory things. How do we explain the phenomena? And we find that the use of conventional principles, mainly used in anomalistic psychology, is one of them. And by conventional principles, one of them is coincidence. You have a flash of intuition that later you found out was true. You know, you felt really bad, and about that same moment, a friend of yours unfortunately died. Many cases of that sort. A conventional explanation would be, well, yeah, that's kind of sad, but it could have been coincidence. You know, a lot of things happen coincidentally in the world, and no, there's no big deal. You are bound to sometimes have experiences of this sort just by coincidence. That's just a simple conventional explanation, which is different from applying new principles, basically saying, no, this is a spiritual process, or something dealing with concepts of multi-space physics, or something like that. Something that will require new principles in science to explain. And in parapsychology, of course, most of our interest is in new principles. We argue that a lot of these phenomena do not have conventional explanations. You cannot reduce everything to coincidence, hallucinations. That's why we have all of these experiments and all these critical ways of looking at the information. But these are things to keep in mind, because you will find both approaches in the literature, and it's very important to always consider, of course, the conventional principles. There are many things that people jump to conclusions too fast that may have conventional principles. There are also kinds of disciplinary approaches. Depending on where do you come from, if you come from psychology, physics, anthropology, or medicine, you will ask different questions. So a psychologist will be interested in the psychological profile of an experiencer, while a physicist will be more interested in the physical mechanism, perhaps defined more as physical variables kind of involved. A physician may be interested to know if there are certain medical conditions that are related, or physiological states or conditions related to the manifestations of some of the phenomena. The cultural context will be the interest of an anthropologist. Excuse me. And this is, again, simplifying. Each of these questions is much more complex coming from each of the disciplines. But it gives us, you know, we need to be alert that when we read the literature, we will find a lot of these approaches, because each person that writes is coming from a different background. And that defines the methods and the things that they are planning to do. I'm sorry also for the distortion of this one, but this is an example of that, what I was saying, applied to what the phenomena say of mental mediumship. Now, you have mediumship here in the center, or at least in the original slide, it used to be in the center, and you can do all kinds of different studies, biological, sociological, medical. You can focus on the communication process. You know, basically, what does the medium says that the information comes from, and in what way it comes from. Some mediums will describe in great detail how they see images and how the images develop. Others will hear voices. Others will combine both of them. That kind of thing. Your approach determines what type of study you are going to do. You can do life history. Basically, what is the life history of the medium? Where was the person born? How was their childhood? Did they have a good or bad childhood? All kinds of questions like that. This is just a particular example with mental mediumship, and there have been studies done with a lot of these approaches over the years, although mediumship is, I would still argue, is one of those neglected areas that even though recently there have been several articles here and there reporting research, compared to other areas, is a very much neglected topic. And we are approaching the end soon here. The issue of the critical mentality is one that I always like to stress, that we need to be aware that all kinds of opinions and evaluations depend on issues such as the conditions of observation, the quality of the methodology, the frame of reference of the person, and the different sources of information. One thing we want to avoid is people that the sources of information are only is media and popular things, such as movies like the movie Poltergeist, TV programs like the X-Files that used to be some years back very influential, or all kinds of popular books, some of which I quite sensational. Conventional explanations are also very important. We need to be aware of all of them as listed here, memory mistakes, subconscious elaborations, certainly the issue of fraud. This is not a question of being a negative skeptic. It's a question of dealing with reality. Not everything that looks psychic is psychic. There are many possible explanations for all kind of phenomena, particularly those that happen outside the laboratory. Or when we see an apparition, especially if it's not veridical, many times we cannot really tell if it's a hallucination that has no psychic component or if it's something else. The point is to be aware of all these things, and also be aware that each of these things has a literature. There is a lot of knowledge compiled about these things. The issue of fraud has always been a problem in the field. In the old days, as you can see in these two books, one comes from 1891, one from 1907, this is the use of fraud in mediumship. The one in the left is basically a medium that decided to reveal in 1891 a lot of the methods of deception that he was using and all other mediums were using. I'm not saying that all mediums do this. Of course not. I think a lot of mediums and probably most are honest, are good people, and they're just trying to do their thing. And many of them have a sense of mission of helping others and the like. But certainly there are also others that have had a career of fraud, of deceiving others. The book on the right is another example by Hubert Carrington. It's just a long list of methods of fraud, not only with mediums, but with psychics and some of the other. We have to realize that this is a big problem, and that when we encounter a psychic, we need really to test things in a critical way, being fair to the person, not accusing people of fraud unless you have really strong evidence, because it's really easy to do that and to affect the person, you know, to damage their career. But as a researcher, you need just to control for these kinds of things. This is just an example of a case of fraud around 1930 that this happened in darkness. The medium, they took an infrared photo. No one could see what was happening, but the medium had escaped control and was grabbing an object, you know, with her hand. It's just a photographic evidence that there was trickery involved in this case, which again may be more an exception. Some people show this more than others. This is actually not fraud, but it's just a way in which things can be so easily faked. This unidentified guy actually is me, a few years younger. I got this photo from someone that had attended this convention, and to my surprise, there was this spirit floating behind me, which was done, of course, with one of these Photoshop utilities that you can put two pictures together and create it. And here, of course, it's obvious that it is created, but it's just to make the point that there are many ways to deceive people. And some of them are funny, like this case, and here there was no intention for deception. The problem is when people try to defraud others, particularly when money is involved. So we need to be aware of that. But my point is that fraud is something to control for, like any other problem in research. You know, you need to be sure you control for sensory cues in an ESP experiment. No one will take serious an ESP experiment if there are clear sensory cues in the environment. The same with things that if you don't control for fraud in an environment where fraud could be an explanation, then you cannot take that evidence too seriously. That doesn't mean that the thing happened through fraud. You know, there are plenty of people that produce real phenomena in very lax conditions because they are not doing science. That's not the whole point. But those of you that want to do science need to pay attention to the issue of control of other explanatory variables. Approaching very much near the end, and just want to say a few thoughts about the importance of parapsychology, which again may be obvious to some of you, others of you that are new to the field, and that's this presentation is addressed mainly to you. Well, may not have thought of these things. I have always felt that one of the big things that parapsychology offers us as psychologists or as human beings is that we can use the findings of parapsychology to understand better the complexity of the mind and how the mind works. If we have phenomena in which we may postulate that there are new mechanisms that science does not accept currently, that's very important. Because the way science works is by bringing things like that to the attention. You know, a new principle that is being explored, eventually one hopes it will be understood. We are not at that stage there. But these phenomena point us to, they are pointers to the need to expand our views of psychology and neurology and many other things. Of course, the impact on the issue of the mind-body problem, which is controversial even within parapsychology. Some people believe there is no such thing as a separate mind. Others believe that the phenomena, especially things like mediumship, reincarnation cases, show not only that there is a separation between mind and body, but that mind may even survive death, that there is consciousness after physical death. We may expand known processes. A lot of what we know about hallucinations will be much further expanded if we will accept, for example, the existence of telepathic hallucinations or hallucinations that may explain out-of-body experiences. We will have to postulate different types of hallucinations from those generally kind of recognized. There is a lot of literature about that now, and a lot of it is very speculative, but the whole point is to try to do that expansion from what we know about hallucinations and perception of the workings of the body as applied to phenomena such as out-of-body experiences. So the phenomena of parapsychology can contribute in those ways to expand our views. And this probably could be my last slide, so I will be stopping very, very soon. There is also the issue that, again, as a psychologist, I find this very important, our whole conception of what is human experience. The variety of human experience, in my view, is expanded by a consideration of parapsychology. You still can talk to many psychologists or many students of human behavior that do not consider parapsychology at all when they talk about the human experience. And in many textbooks, you never hear about out-of-body experiences, you never hear about ESP experiences, about psychokinesis, all kinds of things. That, at least, even if you don't accept the reality of the phenomena, there are experiences that are being reported that by taking these results of a lot of this research seriously, it will expand the scope of the various human disciplines. Certainly, there are implications for behavior, such as after effects, clinical issues. Some of the issues of clinical issues will be discussed later in a presentation in the course by Alejandro Parra. He has done a lot of clinical work. He will be talking about some of these issues. Again, there are clear practical implications there from parapsychology. And of course, the whole idea of fighting superstition and the evaluation of popular claims. There are a lot of ideas out there. Many of them are probably correct. Some of them maybe are not. Like everything in life, human belief sometimes is a mix of things that are wrong, things that are right. We don't know really who has the truth or not. Systematic study of these things may help us with that. I'm not saying that we will solve all our problems and figure out all the mysteries that have been with us since antiquity, but at least we may have better information about some things. And that's all that I'm claiming here. So basically that is my introduction. Here are some suggestions for further reading. Please remember, this is a very basic general introduction. A lot of the findings of the field, you will be hearing them in the presentations that are coming on later, and we are hoping in future online activities to have even more, cover all kinds of other areas that this course will not cover. There are many other places you can find information. I refer you to my blog, which, not because I write it, but I think it does a good job in presenting information. The whole point is to bring out news. So there is a lot about recent books, recent articles, interviews with people in the field. The whole point is to inform, to help people that are interested in getting relevant scientific information. And with that, I will stop, and if there are any questions, I will gladly take them. This is a presentation together with Nancy Singroni, and again, it's meant to be a very preliminary and very, very general beginning to the course. The things that are to come, and you have seen the outline, you have seen the photographs of a lot of the presenters, will be much more specific and much more deeper. You will find much more about the actual findings and problems in the field, the actual questions, the theory.
Okay, definitely anybody, if you have any questions, please put them in the chat. Shirley was asking whether or not UFOs and cryptozoology, that kind of thing, which is not
I don't think that cryptozoology is part of anomalistic psychology. And neither are UFOs by themselves, except when they come to the experience people have with that. Anomalistic psychology includes paranormal belief as one of the topics that they study. And certainly UFOs and the others are part of the paranormal, widely defined. The paranormal is much wider than parapsychological. You know, UFOs and strange creatures, other things like that in cryptozoology, they fall into the general paranormal. So from the point of view of belief, I think anomalistic psychologists will be interested in them. And also in analyzing perceptual aspects. Like a lot of anomalistic psychologists will say that people that see UFOs, they may be making perceptual mistakes, you know, misidentifying objects or having hallucinations. So from that point of view, they will be concerned with it. But it's mainly from their belief and perceptual point of view and not from the point of view of studying the UFOs by themselves or cryptozoology, you know, the appearance of the strange creatures by themselves. You know, if there was a good evidence or a new species or some type of dinosaur in Africa, like some people, you know, report here and there, anomalistic psychologists will not be interested in the actual existence of a brontosaurus or something like that, but will be interested in how people believe that that creature is there, how they reported the psychology of their accounts. So from that point of view, yeah, there is a relationship.
Someone asked, I think it was Trevor, about our personal experiences.
Our personal experiences with psychic phenomena
as well. So if you want to answer that.
Well, I cannot say I have had anything that I have considered striking in my personal experience in terms of psychic phenomena. You know, I have had dreams, intuitions, things like that, but I have never been impressed by my own phenomena. I have been impressed by those of others. I believe that these phenomena are real, and are real in the sense, some of them, of not having conventional explanations. You know, no hallucinations, no coincidence. Or they are real ESP perceptions that need some type of mechanism that we still don't understand, to give you an example. Similarly with mediumship or reincarnation cases, I think some of the cases really require an extension and even may point towards survival of death. But in terms of having had personal experiences, I have never been impressed with the very mild ones I have had.
I'm sort of in the same category. I've had a number of experiences over my life, and some of them I think may well have been psychic precognitive dreams, that kind of thing, but in general they're nowhere near as striking or as confidence producing as the experiences of people that I know personally and the case material certainly that I've read. So we're more interested in the topic than we are experiencers of the phenomena, although I don't think we're completely devoid of some of the milder stuff. One of the questions here was from Cassandra. She says, how does someone get tested when it comes to this kind of stuff? And there are usually quite a number of opportunities out there. I will see if I can't search out some of the ongoing online experiments that are out there that you can get involved in. If you're not connected to the Society for Psychical Research on Facebook, I would suggest clicking on their page, because they routinely will talk about survey studies and other kinds of projects that are ongoing, usually from graduate students in the UK and around the world and so on. So there are some ways to do it. And then it depends on where you live as well. If you're in England, University of Northampton has quite a big group of graduate students. If you're in Brazil, University of Sao Paulo does, and in Juiz de Fora, the federal university there, there's a group. So if, depending on, and if you're in North Carolina or the Southeast and you're near to the Ryan Center, there may be some opportunities there as well. So it depends on where you are on the planet, and then how well you're connected to get some of the notices of online testing that's out there. Jeff has said, seeing that many paranormal events seem to be surrounded by anti-structural or out-of-structure elements, how successful can containing a phenomena that seems to exist
in a controlled environment, in a laboratory, is always a difficult task. But I do not believe the approach of those that say that a lot of these phenomena are destined to be always misunderstood and that will always be that elusive. I think that's a very strong belief system supported by some data, but there is also data that points the other way. I think a lot of these elusive phenomena are elusive because we don't understand them. But there are many conditions and many things that we really do not know now, but that if we improve our knowledge, things will get better. One of the problems that we have is that unlike many other disciplines, like psychology, physics, in parapsychology, you have such a small number of people that are studying these things systematically. Even if you may look at publications and it may look that there is a lot in parapsychology, compare that to any other established discipline, and you will find out that we really have had so little systematic research that maybe we have had much more, or if we can accumulate much more, we will be able to control things better in the laboratory. That's you know, one aspect. The other aspect is that I do not think that we need to have absolute control in a laboratory to really necessarily go forward. Certainly, we had that. It will be a big asset. It will help in many ways. But there are many phenomena that are very difficult to control in psychology. For example, things like creativity, things like hallucinations. The thing is, there are ways always to find ways to study these phenomena, some of them which are not laboratory-based. Sociology, psychology, anthropology are disciplines that can be scientific, and a lot of the database we do is kind of highly elusive. So there are different ways to deal with these things. I'm not saying that there is not a problem, but I think it's a question of trying to continue working on it and not just recognize or assume that there is no point in applying the scientific method because that just will not work. I think that is rather extreme.
He is asking, how about physical theories of psi? Finnish physicist Matti Pekkanen has one hypothesis called topological geometrodynamics. Oh my goodness. And he has tried to incorporate psi into his theory. This sounds very, very interesting, and I think that's probably a good question to bring up when on Saturday to Dr. Ed May, or later in the month when Dean Radin is giving his talk, because neither Carlos nor I are physicists, and there are times, I confess, when at least my eyes glaze over.
Yeah, those are very, very difficult areas, but I think it's great that we are getting theories of that sort. As long as the theories that we have are testable and produce, you know, research that may lead us to either accept, reject the theories, or even better, kind of modify them slowly. I think that's what science is all about, and more theories from the physical point of view are certainly needed. Ed May, I think, will be talking about that later. But I agree, those are very important approaches. I'm up for exploration of any approach, even things that I do not understand, because there's so many, you know, science is so specialized and gets so technical these days. But the important thing that I just like to keep my mind is that regardless of what it is, from physics or biology or anthropology, the important thing is that it's open to be tested, to produce research. And certainly, every theory will have aspects that are non-testable. You know, there are certain assumptions that we make that sometimes we cannot prove directly. But if the theory has enough hypotheses related to it, to the main aspects, eventually I think we will make progress. it's sometimes very hard. Take, for example, the case in psychology. They have the progress with personality theories has been very slow, and some people even deny that there has been any progress at all in the last 50 years. But at least we can accumulate more knowledge and throw away some things, you know, develop new ones, modify them, and the like. It just reminds me of some comments that Jim Carpenter was making recently in an interview that I had with him about his book, First Sight, and that he was making the point that I'm throwing this out and I just want people to read it. I want them to deal with it, to process it, and then try to test it, throw away parts of it if they want, make innovations, you know, new things added to the theory. He was very open about that aspect. And I think that's what I would like to see with all these models that have been mentioned and so many others that are out there. What we need is more actual systematic work with them and much more people coming from different disciplines.
Jeff is asking, what do you think is truly pushing the boundaries back in parapsychology in terms of meaning dynamic, different work? I think you're going to hear a little bit of that from some of the other speakers. Michael Franklin, for instance, is going to be talking about precognition and presentiment as a way to do that. And certainly Ed May and I think Sonali Marwaha, their two-volume work that will be coming out from Prager later on this year has chapters from a lot of us in the field, and there's a lot of hope that that book will also help push the boundaries. Flavio is asking, what's your impression of the field in Brazil? It seems like the title parapsychologist is used by alternate therapists and counselors with lower non-conventional education background. The field remains outside of mainstream academic groups except for anomalistic psychology. Yeah, Henry Stapp too, Trevor.
Yeah. Yeah, I know. I have been in Brazil. I have always enjoyed my visits there, and I have been told by the people that I know there that that's a big problem there, but it's also a problem here. I mean, you look on the parapsychology in the web, and here in the United States, and I assume in other countries, you find kind of a mix of the academic, scientific, and also people that are just trying to sell you a product, and they call themselves parapsychologists, but they don't have any formal training or scientific approach. Yeah, that's certainly a big problem. You know, it's something that in many ways is beyond our control. One of the reasons why we're doing this course is because we want to put out there a lot of talks from people that we know are serious, are highly trained, are academics. Most of the people that are talking have done actual work in the areas that they are discussing, or have had, you know, direct experiences of different sorts. So they know what they are talking. That's very much needed to spread out more that information. But you know, there is very little really that we can do otherwise to control that problem of people that claim they're parapsychologists and they're doing things that are really not scientific. In reality, you know, no one really owns parapsychology. Everyone has a right to do whatever they want. And we can only try to pursue our emphasis and you know, do the best we can to put out what we think is good information.
There's a question from Jeff about accredited degrees for parapsychology available anywhere. And Natasha is giving you good advice about a publication available about education opportunities. If you're willing to sit around for a while and listen to a lecture on our YouTube channel, Parapsychology Online, I have a 30-minute presentation that I did for the PA. Parapsychological Association Convention. They saw a 7-minute version of it on education in parapsychology, and it lists a lot of the schools that are out there, but in general, the accredited degrees are in other disciplines, and then you do your dissertation research or your thesis research on some aspect of parapsychology, such as the PhD that's on offer at University of Northampton, York University, at Sao Paulo, Ruiz de Fora, University of Edinburgh, and so on. These are institutions where you can get guidance and some training and do some work in the field, but there's no such thing as an accredited program that is dedicated to parapsychology only. It just doesn't exist in the world. It did ages ago, but it doesn't anymore. There, you can still get a PhD in psychology in Edinburgh. You can still study with Caroline Watt in the Chrysler Parapsychology Unit. Not a lot of students, but it's a very good program and very good training in psychology as well. And in a sense, it gives you a kind of two strings to the bow, as Lisa Coley of the Parapsychology Foundation likes to say, where you're able to do the conventional work in whatever discipline you're in Edinburgh's case, in psychology, and you're able to work credibly on the scientific side of our field. Ramses De Leon says, Dr. Alvarado, how much impact do you think virtual education in parapsychology, such as this course, will have on the mainstream media and on future parapsychological investigation?
Well, that's hard to say, but I think it will eventually start having an impact. This what we are doing now is really very much, you know, efforts that are at their beginning. You know, we don't know of anyone that has done a course that is kind of so open with so many speakers online before like this. There has been education online before, of course. One of the pioneers was Dick Bierman back, I don't know, in the 80s, I think it was. And those were, you know, a single education, a single course within a university. And it was usually a single instructor, sometimes with a few invited speakers. But I think what we're trying to do here is having all kinds of speakers with different backgrounds, partly because we cannot cover all the topics ourselves, and it's also a good way to control for biases. You know, any biases that we may have, any emphasis that we may have, other people will correct. So we are not so much biological or physically oriented, but we have speakers that are. But I think that eventually as these things start to filter out, as many of you, you know, will get all this information, some of you probably are teachers or researchers or whatever it is, through you, I think, is that these things are going to be affecting others. And certainly everything that we are going to do in the course will be available in the web. So we are hoping that when people are looking for information about education in parapsychology, they will find these materials. And I think eventually, yes, it will have an impact. But as you know, these things always take a long time. It's not a question of a few months or, you know, to change people's views and even to get good information. It's very hard. Even today, you know, we know that a lot of the good information that appears in parapsychology journals or in many other academic journals of physics and psychology, a lot of people are not aware of it. I talk with a lot of people all the time, and many of them are very interested in psychic phenomena, and they really don't know almost anything about what's happening. So that shows that information, the flow of information, takes a long time. Our hope is that these online technologies really move much faster, and, you know, some of these things go viral, but the publicity that we have got for this whole course has been very good, you know, all around in many different countries, all around. I'm hoping that will work and that, yes, there will be an impact, but when it will be, I cannot tell.
That was our philosophy for putting the course together, too. We intend to do another free MOOC next year in January and February as well, and just keep this going because we think one of the primary problems is that people who are interested in parapsychology and in psychic phenomena and paranormal and so on and come at it from many different points of view just don't know that there's actually any scientific or academic work going on. They don't know about the research. They don't know about the theory. And we think it's a great idea to get it out there and let people know who's doing what and bring some of the people in to speak about their own research. And we made a point of getting people who are kind of first person involved in the field as researchers or as participants in research for this first one. So we hope in the future there'll be a lot more information available, and that that will help kind of get the word out that there's actually a field here. There's actually academic and scientific work being done that's been ongoing for over a century. I want to thank you all for your participation. Tom, you might want to copy the chat again because we've gone so far past where we were the last time we copied it. I want to thank everyone who has signed up for the course, and thanks, Tom. And remember that you'll be able to see the chat in the course feed, so you can go over it. The PowerPoint is available on the course schedule page underneath where the recording of this course will be, and within a couple of days it will be up on YouTube. When we post the course to YouTube, we will re-record it and remove the chat box. So the chat box is only available to people who have registered for the course and will not be public on YouTube. Thank you very much. We hope to see you tomorrow. Alejandro Parra from the Instituto Psicología Paranormal will be talking about the clinical and counseling practices and services of his institute. And on Friday, I will do a presentation for those of you who would like to get the certificate for the course, which will be issued by the Parapsychology Foundation. And on Saturday at 2 p.m., please don't miss it, the physicist Edwin May, who was the director of the Stargate program for many years, will be giving a talk on research that he and Sonali Marwaha have been doing on and will present their multiphasic model of precognition. So thank you, everybody. I'm going to be closing off the course
now.
Yes,
thank you.
And definitely explore the course. Don't miss taking a look at the poster sessions and all that stuff on the course schedule. There's a bibliography there. There's lots of PowerPoints and lots of extra stuff. And thanks so much. Have a good evening, everybody. Good morning. Good rest of the evening. Whatever time of the day or night it might be where you are. Hope everything goes well for you, and see you tomorrow. Good night now.
Good night. Bye-bye.